kicking off our new series this week that's going to lead us all the way into Resurrection Sunday. It's called Rethink. And we're going to be talking about shifting perspectives, changing mindsets. How many know that your perspective is your key to the kingdom? How many know that your breakthrough is one thought away? And I'm preaching to myself this morning. Every single one of us struggle with thoughts and mindsets that do not align with the kingdom of God. Come on, somebody. This is why we are instructed to do what? Take every thought that does what? Tries to exalt itself above the knowledge of Jesus Christ. We have to take thoughts captive and change perspective of what we are going through, situations that we face. We have to understand that if God allowed it, then he's going to use it for good. And my base for this morning, if you're taking notes, it's going to be that God is going to turn every assignment against you into an asset for you. God is going to turn every assignment against you into an asset for you. If you have your Bibles, please go to the book of Genesis. It's the first one in the Bible. Chapter 25. This morning we're going to talk about a man named Jacob. Abraham begot Isaac, and Isaac begot Jacob. Isaac had two sons, Jacob and Esau. And in the book of Genesis chapter 25, this is the first mention of the brothers. And Isaac and his wife they conceived. And the Bible says that while Jacob and Esau were still in their mother's womb, they were fighting. Parents, if your kids fight, know that it is natural. One day they will be best friends. Yeah, we all hope if one doesn't kill the other, I suppose. But we see that the first mention of Jacob here in the gospel, or rather the book of Genesis, chapter 25, verse 19, it says this. This is the account of the family of Isaac, the son of Abraham. When Isaac was 40 years old, he married Rebekah, the daughter of Bethuel, the Arminian, and Padarram, the sister of Laban, the Arminian. Isaac pleaded with the Lord on behalf of his wife because she was unable to have children. The Lord answered Isaac's prayer, and Rebekah became pregnant with twins. But the two children struggled with each other in the womb. So she went and asked the Lord about it. "Why is this happening to me?" she asked. And the Lord told her that your sons in your womb will become two nations. And from the very beginning, the two nations will be rivals. One nation will be stronger than the other, and your older son will serve the younger. I've always said this, so I'm not really going to dive too much into it this morning, but when we hear the story of Jacob, we're going to be going over it. Remember, he robbed Esau of his birthright over a cup of stew. Everybody remember that in the Bible? And then he stole Esau's blessing from his father before his father died by dressing up like him. He had to cover himself with animal hair. Everybody remember the story? We'll be touching a little bit of it this morning. But everybody was like, oh man, this guy's deceptive. This guy's messed up. This guy's got issues. But how many know that? Remember, Jacob's mom was involved in the whole process. And the reason she sought to make sure that Jacob received the blessing and not Esau goes back here to chapter 25 when the Lord said to her that your oldest son shall serve the younger son. She knew that the blessing was going to go to the youngest and not the oldest. Are you following me? So the mom had the word of the Lord, and she was going to do whatever it was necessary to make sure that the word of the Lord came to pass in her child's life. Parents, I want to encourage you this morning. Do whatever you need to do to make sure that the promise and the word of God that is spoken over your children are stewarded and it comes to pass. Come on. Don't let your children put sports and other crazy things as a priority over the things of God. Make sure that you steward the things of God in their life to make sure that what God has spoken over them comes to pass. Amen? And so we see, though, from the very beginning, the very mention of Jacob's life, he was known as a wrestler. Jacob was fighting for an identity. He wanted to be number one. Because if you continue reading, when his mother was about to give birth, Esau was on his way out. And the Bible says that Jacob grabbed Esau's heel, his ankle, his foot. He tried to pull him back in. He's like, no way, bro. I'm going first. We all know that Jacob lost that fight. Esau was born first. So from the very first mention of Jacob's identity, we see him as a struggler. We see him as a fighter, a wrestler. But not just fighting and wrestling for the sake of fighting and wrestling because he has a bad temper. But he fought and he wrestled because he was trying to gain an identity. He was trying to gain a position. Come on, somebody. And Jacob's life was marked by this. As a matter of fact, Jacob means deceiver or supplanter, one who wrestles with man. Jacob grows up. Like I said, you can read the accounts throughout Genesis 26, Genesis 27, Genesis 28, where Jacob goes through the process of deceiving his brother Esau out of his birthright and his blessing, his inheritance. Because you got to understand, the firstborn gets everything. The secondborn gets a portion, but the firstborn's portion is much greater than the secondborn. And not only is the firstborn's blessing and portion greater, but the authority that rests on the firstborn is as though it's the same authority that was on the father. Are you following me here? And so because Jacob struggled with identity, because he struggled with who he was, because he was always wrestling, struggling, and fighting, not just with people, but how many know that Jacob's main fight was with himself? I want to propose to you this morning that the assignment in Jacob's life wasn't Esau trying to kill him or people trying to deter him, but rather it was the thought process that went on in the mind of Jacob telling him that I'm no good and I'm not going to be any good until I get what my brother has, until I have his identity, until I have his blessing, until I have his portion, I will never be enough. How many times in life, and I'm speaking to myself, do we struggle with I'm not good enough? Do we struggle with, I have to pretend and fight and wrestle and struggle to be somebody else? Because if people saw me as I was, as I am, I'm not too sure they'd accept me. So I will wear my brother's Esau's clothes, and I will put on animal skin to make myself hairy like him, God forbid. I don't know if they were Jewish or Italian. I'm not really sure. But I will do whatever is necessary to make sure I get what he has because I'm not good enough. Last night I was having a conversation with Pastor Gina about this very issue and processing and going through things even throughout my life. For anybody that tells you that somehow anybody in leadership in the church has got it all figured out and I'm great and, you know, we don't struggle with anything. If they tell you that, they're trying to sell you something because they're lying to you. I personally have a theology, a belief system, and that is supported through the Word of God, that God actually uses the most messed up of us all, the most broken of us all, the most confused. And the reason he chooses those kind of people is so that way he receives the glory in the end. If I built the church based upon my gift set and my talents and my abilities and my this and my that, then guess who gets the glory at the end of it all? But when God takes a broken, messed up nobody in some no-name town in the middle of nowhere, and God elevates those people to a certain place, everybody will look and say, but God. So here's Jacob struggling, wrestling, fighting, as many of us do. And look at Jacob's life. It's marked by pushing people away. It's marked by distancing himself, struggling with himself. And we fast forward here to Genesis chapter 28, where God lays Jacob down. He sleeps. Remember, the heavens open up and he sees angels ascending and descending upon that place. And he calls the place Bethel, the house of God. And I find it interesting that Jacob now makes a vow in verse 20 of chapter 28. He says, then Jacob made this vow, if God will indeed be with me and protect me, and if he will provide me with food and clothing, and if I return safely to my father's home, then he will be my God. We don't realize that his vow was conditional. You see, because Jacob was still struggling with the same issue he was always struggling with. When Jacob saw the heavens opened, it wasn't like, oh my gosh, God is awesome. It was, wow, this guy can take care of me. Because I'm still fighting and I'm still struggling to get mine. I'm still fighting and I'm still struggling to get my blessing, my provision. I'm still struggling and fighting, so I'm taken care of. How many in the church are taking their eyes off of what God is doing because we're still focused on ourselves? We're not floored by the fact that heaven opened up and God's going to move and revival's going to break out. We're like, God, where's my provision? God, where's my breakthrough? God, where's my protection? Because we're still lost in an identity that we haven't found. We're still identifying ourselves under our brother's identity, under the world's identity, under the identity of our talents and our gifts, and we haven't learned just to be sons. And so the Bible says from this moment that Jacob goes and he has some issues with his wives, one named Leah, one named Rachel. One wife has all of his love but can't give him a child. One wife can give him children, but she doesn't have his love. And everybody remembers the story of Jacob and his father-in-law, right? He goes to his father-in-law named Laban, and Laban was a crooked man, and he swindled him into marrying both of his daughters. They weren't Mormon. It was okay back in the Old Testament. And Jacob kind of got a little bit of what he always gave out. Remember, Laban said, if you serve me for 7 years, I'll give you my daughter. And he goes and he wakes up the next morning and he realizes the woman in his tent is not the woman that Laban promised him. So he works another 7 years for the youngest daughter. And then at the end of all this, he's like, hey, Laban, listen, I've had enough of you. I've done everything I said and I vowed I would do for you. Please let me go and let me have the flock and the sheep and the goats that are mine. And remember, Laban's like, all right, but, and remember, we all know the story. Laban tried to swindle Jacob. I remember Jacob carved the spots in the stick and he threw it in the watering hole, and all the sheep that went and drank from that watering hole, when they conceived what? Their children had spots. The lambs had spots, and that was all his. That's how they differentiated what was Laban's and what was Jacob's. And Jacob goes, but now Laban's trying to kill him. And so Jacob's hiding. And because one of the things is, when you live under a false identity, when you're trying to perform, you will always set yourself up for failure. You're always going to reap what you sow. Those bitter root judgments that you're holding against people, when you think you're not good enough, other people will treat you as though you're not good enough. When you feel like you're less than, other people will treat you like you're less than. Remember, you shall love your neighbor as you love yourself, if you can't love yourself, you're not going to love others. And when you're not loving others, others will not love you in return. And you create this cycle of hurt and pain because you're lost in an identity. And what if the assignment of the enemy isn't to tempt you with murder? It's not to tempt you with adultery. It's not to tempt you with theft, but it's to keep you tripped up in your own thoughts. What if the enemy's assignment against you is to lose yourself in an identity less than what God has purposed for you? I honestly believe that many Christians are caught and stumbling over not horrible sins, but we're stumbling over second best for our life. We're giving up the best for good enough. We're giving up what we want the most for what we want now. And because of that, many Christians are living in an identity where their performance marks who they are. And the moment that that gift or that performance is no longer good enough, and this is what happens with leaders all across this world. Most leaders live in a performance-based mentality. When you live in a performance-based mentality, you will always squash people who you feel are more talented than you, because you feel you are there because you are the best at whatever it is that you do. The moment you see somebody who does what you do better, you will squash them down because you think the only reason you're there is because you can do it. And if somebody else does it better than you, they're going to take your spot. And so you live in a cycle of raising up people to a place where you can use them, but still control them. I love what Rick Pino said. Pastor Ryan mentioned it Wednesday. He was in a Q&A session at a conference, and somebody said, how do you know you're ready to transition from sonship to fatherhood or daughtership to motherhood? And Rick said, when you can look at the next generation, when you can look at sons and daughters pass you by and be excited about it, that's when you know you're ready to father. But most people are stuck in this performance-based, I'm not good enough mentality. So when we see people who are better, we do one of two things. If we see other people who are more gifted and more talented than us, just like Jacob did to Esau, you either try to get what they have and steal it from them, or you take them out. And so it's not really a church that's developing a culture and developing a family. You're really a CEO or a slave driver who's raising up task people who to help you build your empire. And God understood that Jacob's destiny was much greater than just being a taskmaster or just being a man who struggles. So then what happens if you fast forward all the way over to Genesis chapter 32, God decides that he's going to encounter this old man now. At this moment, Jacob's probably around 92 years old. He has gone through the majority of his life. We all think young Jacob. He's 92 to 96 years old when he's encountering the angel of the Lord. And the Bible says that he is laying down because he's scared. How many remember he hears Esau, his brother, is out to get him? Now, Esau is older. I would have loved for somebody to YouTube that. Esau and Jacob having a fight in the middle of the desert. Come here, son. You know, like. And he's so afraid that he separates his family, right? He separates his two wives, Rachel and Leah, right? Because he feels that if Esau catches up with me and he kills one of the families, at least I have another group of kids and a wife still alive. I don't care what kind of messed up family thing you have. This was messed up. And while Jacob is afraid, and 90-something years of struggling with an identity, God meets him. Why is it that we think we have to have it all figured out and right and perfect before God will show up? I would actually say to you, it's the opposite of how God actually worked. God shows up when I'm in the deepest, darkest, most messed up part of my life. That's when God shows up. He doesn't show up when I got my stuff together and I feel like I'm going. He shows up when I'm so broken and lost and confused and I'm saying, who else would love me? Who else would accept me? God's like, I will. Who else? Me. This guy. It was never a surprise to me from the beginning. I knew you were broken and messed up from when I chose you. Nothing's hidden from me. I'm the one who formed you in your mother's womb. And yeah, I would have preferred if we could have avoided some of these scars, but I'll meet you where you are. He's the one who chases us down. He's the one who leaves the 99 and comes after us, y'all. I didn't find Jesus. Jesus found me. I was lost. I was dead. I was lost in my trespasses and my sins. He found me. And here's the amazing thing. I know this kind of breaks some of our theology, but it's not like God looked at me and saw this awesome person and said, oh, he's worth saving. I wasn't worth saving. I had no worth. The only reason God saved me is because he's good and he's worthy and he loves me. I didn't deserve it. That's the amazing, that's the miracle of the gospel. I didn't deserve it. But he did it anyway. And here's Jacob. In the natural, doesn't deserve it. But God meets him. God shows up. And we all know the story. He wrestles with Jacob. Could you imagine that? An angel wrestling with a 92-year-old man. But this dude must have not been like a feeble 92, because he was like, because the angel said to him, you got to let me go because morning is coming. See, I don't care what condition you feel your strength is in. When you want something bad enough from God, you'll do whatever it takes. People will be like, I can't pray for more than 5-10 minutes. Well, how bad do you want your healing? How bad do you want your breakthrough? You go in and you don't let God. Because Jacob said, I will not let you go till you bless me. But look what the angel of the Lord, Jesus himself, said to Jacob. Okay, Jacob. Or actually, he didn't even call him Jacob. He said, then what's your name? His whole life he had been struggling with an identity from the womb. Struggling as supplanter, struggling with wrestler. You see, the angel asked him what's his name because God cannot and will not bless who you pretend to be. God cannot and will not bless who you pretend to be. In that moment, Jacob had to confess and admit, yeah, I'm broken. I'm Jacob. I'm the supplanter. I'm the deceiver. I'm the liar. That's me. Remember when David committed adultery and the prophet comes to him and tells him this story about a rich man who had all these sheep. But the rich man saw this poor guy who only had one sheep, but the rich man wanted his one. Everybody remember the story? So the rich man had the other man killed and he took it. And David said, who's this man? You know, and the prophet said, what would you do? And David said, I'm the man. Sometimes we just got to get real before God and say, God, I'm not accepting this. I'm not professing this identity, but this is who I am. And if I'm expecting you to bless, touch, change, shape me, then I got to get real with myself. And God said, from this moment on, you will not be Jacob, but you will be Israel. You see, Jacob means deceiver. Israel means prince with God. In one encounter with God, he was transformed from a supplanter, deceiver, wrestler, liar into a prince. And this is what I want to share with you. The reason God changed his name wasn't for God's benefit. It was for Jacob's. God wanted Jacob to see himself as God saw him. The only way we will understand the assignments against us can be turned into assets for us is if we start to see it the way the Father sees it. How do I know that's true? If you go to the book of Exodus, chapter 3, Moses encounters the bush. He asks the bush, "Who should I say sent me?" The bush says, "It's God. Say that I am." And then a few verses later, Moses goes to the people of Israel. He says, "The God of our father Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." He didn't call him Israel. God didn't identify with Israel. God identified with Jacob. Which means God identifies with your mess. He's not ashamed to be identified with your past. God is not ashamed to be identified with your brokenness. God is not ashamed to be identified with your mess-ups and your screw-ups. He says, yeah, Jacob needed to be encouraged, and he needed to be called Israel, but I'm comfortable with calling him Jacob. As a matter of fact, I'm comfortable being known as the God of Jacob. So no matter where you are, God is comfortable being associated with you as long as you're comfortable being changed by him. It's about rethinking. It's about perspective. Because when you keep on reading, in chapter 36... Jacob goes back to Bethel. This time he doesn't go to Bethel, the house of God, as Jacob. He goes as Israel. He doesn't walk normal. He walks with a limp. Because how many know that when you encounter God, you're marked for life? All these people who say they had this encounter and that encounter and third heaven experience and this experience and that experience and they're acting and talking and living the same, I question the encounter. Because when you encounter, I just need one encounter to be changed forever. And not only does the encounter change me, but it changes how people perceive me. So the very assignment that was on Jacob's life since birth in the womb got turned into an asset. You see, Jacob used this tenacity, this boldness, this stubbornness for his own desires and wants, getting his brother's birthright. But God turned that God-given tenacity into an asset for the kingdom, because out of Israel would be birthed the 12 tribes. God's blessing was on his life, and he needed a man who was not going to give up, who was going to keep on believing even after his son Joseph, who he thought was dead. Everybody remember the story. Keep on reading the book of Genesis. It's the story of, remember, Joseph and the coat and the favor and his brothers. And there's a famine, and Joseph goes and becomes the second most powerful man in all the world. And good old Jacob, remember, comes back to his son. How many know that it took a strong belief, confidence, tenacity, boldness, what we would call stubbornness, to hold on to the promise of God? And the Lord said, you know, the enemy might try to use your stubbornness for your good, but I'm going to turn your stubbornness into an asset. I'm going to teach you how to hold on to me and not let me go till I bless you. Come on, somebody. You might have used that stubbornness before to get your way, but I'm going to teach you how to use your stubbornness to hold on to the things of God and not let them go, no matter how difficult or how hard it seems. I'm going to teach you in this moment, in this season, how to turn every assignment against you into an asset for you. I'm going to show you that your name was never really Jacob in the first place. It was always Israel in my eyes. But even though you saw yourself as Jacob, I want you to understand I'm not ashamed of Jacob. I'm not afraid of Jacob. I'm not embarrassed by Jacob. I'm not ashamed by your sin. I'm not embarrassed by your sin. I don't care if people like you, if you have 10,000 followers on Facebook. I'm not ashamed by your faults or your shortcomings. I love you just the way you are. And when I do change your name, it's not for my benefit. It's for yours, so you can start to see yourself as I've always seen you. You see, Jacob, what you don't realize is I visited your mother before you were even born. and I prophesied your purpose and your destiny. I spoke your destiny into existence before you even took a first breath. Don't you ever doubt for a second, no matter what kind of hell or high water you go through. You remember that I've spoken purpose over your life. You remember that I've spoken destiny over your life. I don't care how many times you fall, as long as you keep getting up, keep fighting, keep running, keep surrendering to me, keep laying yourself. Because here's the thing, when Jacob got back to Bethel, this time there were no conditions with the vow. Remember the first time he was at Bethel, he said, if God does this and if God does that. The second time he comes to Bethel, he just brings a sacrifice and he lays it on the altar. You see, once we encounter God and once we have a proper perspective of who we are, there's no more conditions to God. It's just, I love you and you love me. And as long as we have that, I don't need anything else. All the treasures and all the promises and all the fame of the world, they don't mean a thing to me because I have you. And that means I can revisit the house of God without an expectancy of getting anything from you. I come to the house of God ready to give something to you. See, Jacob was always trying to get, but Israel gives. One moment in the presence changed his mind, and he rethought the process of himself. Who am I? And I'm sure there were people who knew the Jacob of old. Oh, look, it's Jacob. You better hold tight to your purse. If he offers you stew, don't take it. And Jacob's like, who's Jacob? Never heard of the guy. Hi, nice to meet you. My name's Israel. No, you're that dude that guy's dead. My name's Israel. Oh, no. You're the son of... No, you don't understand. That guy is dead. The deceiver, the supplanter, he was killed one night by an angel. And this guy came out. See, it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. And that the key to my breakthrough is not trying to fix myself in my own abilities, but the key to my breakthrough is getting with God and saying, God, I'm not leaving here till I see things differently. Because how many know Jacob was always Israel to God? He was always Israel. Jacob was the one who had to catch up with God's reality. You are therefore now a new creation. Old things are gone, and behold, all things have become new. I want you to rethink every struggle you've been going through or you have gone through. Everything in your life that you feel is a weakness. Every area that you've been struggling in. And I want you to start to say to yourself, how is it that God can take this thing and make it an asset for me? What the enemy meant for evil, God is turning around for my good. He can take all things, work all things together for the good to those who love him and are called according to his purposes. I might be struggling right now, but I don't need 12 steps. I don't need tons of counseling sessions. I'm not against that. We do this. And sometimes you need deliverance. You need to go through these things. But what you need more than anything else is an encounter, a face-to-face encounter with God, and let him whisper into your ear how he sees you. Say this morning, and at this, we're going to prepare. I want Pastor Joel to get ready. We're going to be taking communion. The ushers can start to get ready with the elements. But I say this to you this morning from a very, very personal place. I want you to understand that I'm still struggling as Jacob in my mind. And this was actually not the direction of the original message. But after my talk with my wife last night, I started to understand the benefit of vulnerability. You know, there are times where you have to unmask yourself. And I'm not saying show the whole world your dirt. You got to be careful who you let in your tent. But one of the worst things a leader can do is somehow present this, I'm perfect. I've got my stuff all together. I've never had a fault. I don't struggle with thoughts. I'm perfect. And one day you can aspire to be like me. I don't know, I side with Paul when he says, I'm the chiefest of sinners. The only reason Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ, is because he was learning as he was going too. He knew the importance of grace and mercy. Church, every morning I wake up, if his mercies weren't new, and if his grace wasn't more sufficient, I'd be in a bad place. But thank God that his blood speaks a better word. And thank God that even when I still feel like a Jacob, the Lord is constantly prophesying, you're Israel, you're Israel, you're Israel. And in my life, I've personally fought with identity. That has been the greatest struggle I've had. Trying to be something to people that I wasn't. Proving myself to people, trying to maintain a name, maintain an identity, and doing whatever was necessary to live up to the expectation that people and society placed. Anybody else know what I'm talking about? Am I just... And that expectation, that lifestyle led to hurt, pain and confusion and loss. And then you find yourself at 36 years old saying, I don't even know who I am half the time. Is this actually the real me, or is this the me who I trained myself to be because this is what people expect of me? And so you live under false expectations and requirements. And you're always fighting for your next blessing. You're always fighting for your name, because if people saw the real me, if I took off Esau's clothes for a minute and the father saw me as I was, would he actually accept me? And God would say to you this morning, I wouldn't accept you as Esau, but I accept you as Israel. See, you settled for second best. You thought the blessing of Esau is what you wanted. But I had the blessing of Israel for you. I want you to understand this morning that no matter what you're going through, no matter what situations you face, no matter what trials you go through, God will turn every assignment against you into an asset for you. And you will stand back and look at that thing that you ran from, that you hid from and you fought against, and you will say, oh wow, that's why you were in my life, because you were getting me from here to there, and this thing that I thought was taking me out was actually setting me up, and this thing that I thought was going to be my demise actually turned into my deliverance. And what I realize is that every arsenal and tool the enemy had in his bag that he formed against me in my life, number one, I face it understanding it shall never prosper. But when it does come against me and it does wound me, I understand, I know it's cliche, but whatever doesn't kill me only makes me stronger. And every battle and every trial and every tribulation that I go through and that I face, even if I barely make it out, I crawl on my hands and knees only by the grace of God, but I can can stand and say, I made it out. The devil didn't take me out. That sin didn't take me out. Addiction didn't take me out. Alcoholism didn't take me out. That lust didn't take me out. I overcame it. The sin in my life, it might have had a grip on me, but by the blood of Jesus and by the power of the cross, it was defeated. And the thing that was divine set against me to take me out actually set me up, and look at me now. I might have a limp, but it's only because God touched me. So, Pastor Joel, as he comes, I just want to prophesy corporately over you. You're good enough. I know this sounds cliche also, but if you were the only one on earth, Jesus still would have went through and did everything he did for you. God absolutely, totally, 100% is smitten by you. He absolutely loves you. And when he looks at you, he doesn't see supplanter, deceiver, murderer, rapist, killer, thief, pickpocket, or robber. He sees blessed, mighty one, son, daughter, in whom he's well pleased. And the Father this morning wants you to start to rethink yourself. So, Father, in the authority of Jesus Christ, we break off shame. We break off a false narrative. We break off the Jacob spirit that would try to consistently strive to perform better, to perform greater, and outdo myself. And, Father, we ask that you would release the spirit of Israel, somebody who is well pleased with you, and whom you are well pleased with. Father, break the orphan spirit this morning and release the spirit of adoption. Let perfect love cast out all fear. Father, we break off rejection. We break off every word of every person that has rejected you, that has hurt you, that has abandoned you, that has left you. And Father, we ask that you would just release right now your unfailing love. Release, Father, right now. Rest. No longer to struggle, but Lord, may we rest in your love. May we rest in your peace. Father, break off performance. You're not impressed by what we do. You simply love us for who we are. So, Father, let us operate and do out of who we are and not try to do to become somebody we're not. May we find satisfaction in who you created us to be. May the ears be happy that they're ears, and the kidneys be happy that they're kidneys, and the hands be happy that they're kidneys. Lord, break off the spirit of comparison right now in the name of Jesus. We break the spirit of comparison. Comparison is the greatest killer of contentment. Let us learn to find satisfaction and contentment in who you created us to be and not look at somebody else, because, Lord, that person is probably struggling with their own set of things. Let's not compare our behind the scenes to somebody else's highlight reel. Let us rejoice in who you made us to be. And Father, start in me this morning. Start in my heart, my mind. In the moments we feel the most lost, broken and confused, in that moment, God, come and meet us. Encounter us. May we realize, just as Jacob, that the heavens are opened over us, even when we feel like trash. Even even when we still feel like a deceiver, you still smile over us. So thank you, Lord, that you don't rate us on a goodness scale, but you are well pleased. We give you the honor.